I'll take that one. Unless, are you guys using that chair right back there?
I don't believe we are.
All right.
I think it has a decent spot.
And now we're in Kuwait, and I'm going to say salam alaikum. I say Madri. Madri is I don't know. And let me tell you, I use that phrase a lot. I don't know. Madri. So my name is, I had it at one time. Arabic is hard.
I would just like to, my name is, I'll just pretend, Misi. Tracy Kloeckl-Jimenez. And thanks to Jan Kurtz, she had the idea of calling Jeff and asking if he would present for us. I don't think I need this. And so we're really happy.
A little louder?
Yep. We're really happy that he's here and has such great information. So just a reminder to turn your cell phones off so that's not distracting. And Jeff is willing to answer your questions for sure afterwards. I'm not sure if during as
well. Well, it depends on what they are.
You might want to. So please join me in giving him a warm applause. For him.
I did bring this, but I'm not going to wear it because I'm kind of long up here, but it's one of my, it's American Eagle, and it says Kuwait at the top. I just wanted to wear some Kuwait things. I encourage you and would welcome you to answer or ask any questions during the presentation. And afterwards, I hope you linger for a while and look at some of the things. You might wonder, what the heck do you have bags over there? I'll talk about that a little bit later. But there's some nice little artifacts over on that table and then behind me. So. I will stay as long as you're here, and if I, at 12, I think at 1 o'clock we have to end formally, but I'm sure willing to stay here a little bit longer because I have quite a few pictures to share with all of you. So let me give you a quick background of how the heck did you get to Kuwait? I was in the school district, and it's absolutely fantastic to see so many 181 folks here today. What a great school district, and I'm going to be an audience member for Bob's next month, so make sure you all come back for Bob's. I'm sure that's going to be a full house. But anyway, I was hired by Bob in Brainerd here in 1975 and had 36 fantastic, unbelievable years like all of us did who were in the Brainerd district. And for about 22 years, I was an elementary art teacher and Washington Middle School art teacher. And then it was sort of becoming too, like, I need to change. But A, I love Brainerd, I didn't want to leave. E, I love the school district, so I sat down with Bob, and as some of you know Bob Gross, he said, you know, I could really see you going into leadership, into administration, and I was like, So I thought about it, and ended up going to St. Cloud sabbatical, and got my administrative degree, waited 1 year, and then I got the call from Bob, and at that time I think it was Gary Phillips, and I became the principal of Lincoln and Whittier School, and did that for a couple of years, and then went to Lincoln full-time because Lincoln needed full-time. And then did Lincoln for about 9 years and then became the principal at Harrison School. And that's where I ended my time with Brainerd. And I retired in 2010. And I student taught way back in 1974 in Mexico City. It was a cooperative program. I don't know if they still have it, Jan. And I was a St. Cloud student, but I was, during my student teaching, I was a Mankato State student and went to Mexico for student teaching. Loved it. I love being immersed in a different culture. I love being a minority. I love not knowing how to find things because that forces you to talk and communicate with people, and I loved that. And that little seed stayed in me, and when I retired then, 40 or 36 years later, I wanted that experience again. But I didn't want Mexico, I wanted further away. So I went to the job fair the spring of 2010 when I was still principal of Harrison School. Bob recommended me going to Boston. There are folding chairs out in the, are there chairs for these folks? Come in. And I'm folding chairs outside. So I went to Boston to the job fair. Huge job fair for teachers and administrators in schools who want to get an international position. And I was too old. And I was like, I'm too old, what are you talking about? Many countries you cannot turn 60 on a work visa. And I really had my sights set on like Ecuador or somewhere in South America, Brazil, or maybe Helsinki or Vienna, those kinds of things. And many of those countries would not allow people who are 60, I was 58 at the time, to work after 60. So I was frustrated. 2 days I had not one interview. And the last day I walk into the exhibition hall, you know, and most of the places are all shut down, I'm thinking, well, this was a waste of money, blah, blah, blah. And I turn around and here's this lady, just kindly lady sitting there, and above her was American Creativity Academy, the creativity kind of got me as an old art teacher. Kuwait. And I'm thinking, Kuwait? And of course your mind, sand, hot, camels, desert, the war, Saddam, oil. That's Kuwait. So I walk over, sit down with her, and was totally blown away by her friendliness, her welcoming attitude. Had an interview with her the next day. And then she said, this was my first job fair. I have to do about three others, but I'll call you back in about 2 weeks. I'm sitting in my house, which is only a stone's throw from the college here, and I got a call. She said, I want you to come and be the principal of the elementary boys campus. And I said, you got it, I'm there. And she said, by the way, I want to tell you that I just hired the principal of the elementary girls campus. I don't know if you know her, she's from Mora, Minnesota. So we get on the plane and we meet each other. Had never met her. What's Mora, 80 miles away, maybe 90 miles, I don't know. So here, she knew she had two Minnesotans who, you know, we've got a good reputation if you didn't know that already, work ethic and all that. And so we both go over and she takes over the girls campus elementary and I take over the boys campus elementary. And for 4 years I lived and worked and had fun and traveled and have nothing but fond memories. Now I will admit though, my last year I was there, I was ultra frustrated. And that's where you know, somebody already asked me, why did you decide to leave Kuwait? Because I was frustrated. Just, it starts to wear on you after a while. But I made it for 4 years, which is actually longer than most do over there. So, we're going to start here, and I'm just gonna kind of follow these pictures. And I don't know why my screen just went blank. And Tracy, are you here?
I'm here.
Okay. Oh, do you have a remote to click? That would be nice. So, I flew out the middle of August 2010, and then, this was like my last photo of Minneapolis. Anybody know what I'm looking at down there? I'm a huge Twins fan, and the Twins were playing that night. I don't know if they won the game, but that's downtown Minneapolis, and of course, I'm this, you know, Midwestern, well, Brainerd's not that small anymore, but small town guy going to this unknown land over on the other side of the world where it's freaking hot. So, it's about a 21-hour flight, Minneapolis to Amsterdam, and then you change planes to Amsterdam straight down to Kuwait. And the plane, you know, I hadn't flown international for a long, long time, but most of the planes have a little TV screen on the back of the thing in front, and you could actually, I mean, there's movies, television shows, so many things, and you could also follow the flight. They have the, you know, the plane actually moves, and you can zoom in on the map, and pull out on the map. So I was having a lot of fun with that, because I love maps. And anyway, this was one I just shot with my camera. It doesn't show up real well. In fact, it doesn't show up very well at all. But I had crossed the Black Sea, which I'd heard about. Here's Larnaca, this is the island of Cyprus. Amman, Jordan. But down here, you can barely see the word bag. And I thought, oh, lordy, 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 we're flying over Baghdad. And of course, that just brings up all kinds of images in your mind. And anyway, we made it safely. And just before we landed, just before we landed, it even turned the plane in the direction you're going. It's probably about 10 o'clock at night, and we're just about landing. You can see at the top, 105. This is about 8, 9, 10 o'clock at night. And I just thought, wow. I mean, I like heat. I've grown up, I'm a Minnesotan, and if I have to take summer, fall heat, or winter, dry, cold, I'll take heat. And so I thought, well, I can handle the heat. And there you see Saudi Arabia, and this is the country of Kuwait. And now, if you switch to the next one, this is an actual satellite image. So here's Saudi Arabia, this is Iraq to the north, this is the Kuwait harbor, and the Kuwait is nothing but sand. There's not even palm trees, there's nothing. Nothing, there's no cactus, there's no tumbleweed blowing. If I haven't told you, there's nothing. This is the city, and the city now is about 4.1 million. When I was there, it was about 3.5. The main part of the city is right here. This is the Arabian Gulf. This is Falaka Island, which is a very historic site. I've got pictures of Falaka. But my school and I live right about here. And Kuwait is a very large city, but it's a city of contrast. You've got high rises, and right next door you've got old buildings that are still kind of there from the invasion, and there's bullet holes in some of the buildings. It's pretty amazing. So I was taken to my apartment, which unfortunately was not with the other people because there were so many people coming to our school that year. I got stuck in this massive apartment complex by myself. So I did, you know, and they're all speaking Arabic. So a real strange feeling, but the morning I got up and was getting ready to be picked up for orientation, this was the little living room, all furnished, quite nice. And I looked out my front window and that was my view. So from the jack pines of and lakes of Brainerd and Baxter to the brown beige of Kuwait. Very highly concentrated, lots of, these are all apartment buildings. I mean, 90% of people in Kuwait City live in these tall apartment complexes.
Is that water on the roof?
Yes. Hear what you're saying?
Actually, we're talking about the yellow containers on the left.
Yes, this is all water. Yep. And they have no problem with hot water. They have no problem with hot water. So this is Wendy. This is Wendy Anderson from Mora, Minnesota. She's back over in Kuwait. She came back here and retired and went back again. She missed it. And this was the gal who was hired as my assistant principal from Alaska, Miss Cleo. You go by first names over there. So this was Miss Wendy, Mr. Jeffrey, Miss Cleo. It took me a few weeks, actually, to get used to being called Mr. Jeffrey. You know, for 36 years, it was Mr. DeVaney. Mr. DeVaney at Target. Hey, Mr. DeVaney. And then I'm over in Kuwait, and it's Mr. Jeffrey. And at first, it's, you know, that thing, and you wanted to say, you be respectful. Call me Mr. DeVaney. And then you kind of realize, older. You're in Kuwait. This is their culture. And coming back here, being in Target and down the aisle, hey, Mr. DeVaney. It's like, who's that? And actually, first name, that's one of the things that is fascinating and I loved about the Middle East was that personal thing. The guys, you know, they do the cheek kissing and that kind of thing. Very, very touchy-feely, but I liked it. So anyway, that's the Kuwait Towers. That is the iconic architectural symbol of Kuwait. You know, Paris would be the Eiffel Tower, that sort of thing. The Kuwait Towers are the iconic symbol. That's an actual rotating restaurant, and at the top is an observation deck, and it survived the invasion of Saddam, which is pretty amazing. But anyway, this was our first full day there, and again, it was very, very hot. Now, my assistant principal, Miss Cleo, was going to be a teacher somewhere else, and something happened, and she just at the last minute got the job for Kuwait. She didn't do her homework. I just gave you a clue. Does anybody know what I'm saying?
She's brought snowshoes.
Correct. Correct. This is a big no-no. And so Wendy is very into detail and all that. So she knew that. So the next day, she was not dressed like that. But that was just a mistake she made. And the Kuwaitis are forgiving of that. But if you did it over and over again, they would not be happy about that. So this is just one section of the downtown area of Kuwait. Again, like I said, it's a very large city. very similar to the metro of the Twin Cities. Twin Cities is what, about 3 million, I think, now they're saying? Is it more than that? Anyway, and this is the Alhambra Tower. This is about a 68, I believe, story, and it's the world's largest. They call it a sculpted tower. It actually, you can see it kind of turns as you go up. Pretty amazing building. Of course, Kuwait is in the dust, in the shadows of Dubai and Abu Dhabi, but it's still there's still some beautiful architecture there. So these are just some shots I took, and again, I have many, many more, but these were just a couple I took. These are not natural. These were all planted. I mean, if you see any green, that's not natural. That's planted. And this is just one little area. Right here, you can see a mosque. If I would have done a 360, there'd be a mosque. There'd be a mosque. There'd be a mosque. Kuwait has the highest percentage of mosques, that's what I was told, of any Arabic country. Not hundreds, there are thousands of mosques. So, you have to eat. So one of the first places they took us was to their version of Cub. Yeah. And it's called, they don't call it TSC, but that's their symbol, TSC. That stands for the Sultan Center. And you've heard of Sultan, the Sultanate of Oman. Sultan is like a ruler. So that's their Cup foods. And of course, we had no idea, you know, what's this going to be like, their grocery stores. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. It was just like walking into a Cup or wherever you go, Super One or Costco. Well, it's not like a Costco. Anyway, vegetables, fruit, meats, amazing. Almost all from Egypt or Lebanon. Kuwait grows just a few things. They're known for their cucumbers and their onions. They take pride in their cucumbers and their onions. Don't ask me why. But anyway, and these were our hosts for the orientation, Gary and Liz. They were teachers at our school. Wonderful folks from Canada, from Vancouver Island. You know, that's the other thing about teaching in an international atmosphere. It just, your friends are from Vancouver, right? From England, from Bangladesh. That's so fascinating. And this was, we were walking out to the cars, and I'll have to admit, the first time I saw these, I thought, why, what the? So, and it's for heat. Most of the parking lots there are all covered because of the heat. And it's not just the heat, it's the, you know, even here in the summertime, your steering wheels are like, yeah. That's nothing compared to the steering wheels there, nothing. When it's 120, 125 out, you can't imagine how hot that surfaces get. Now we left the grocery store, and this is a really interesting shot. Anybody know what a souk is? A souk, S-O-U-K. That's the souks. If you go to Amman, Jordan, if you go to Istanbul, if you go to Kuwait, if you go to any of those cities, they have their souks. That's an old shopping center, but it's not like Westgate Mall. It's an old outdoor, you know, almost like vendors, like a farmer's market. And this is the old souk in downtown Kuwait, historic, fascinating place. Go to any of those cities, go to their souks. Make sure that's on your list. And they had a food court. This would be their food court. And tables are just plastic chairs, nothing fancy. And then these huge fans, and then below the fans are these misters that just send up a fine mist of water. And then the fans just sort of, you just kind of feel that cooling effect. Because it's so dry, you don't sweat. It just dries immediately. So those were, that's another thing. It's like, wow, never thought of that before, because we don't need those here. And the interesting thing is this food court, kind of like here, there were about 8 different little kitchens that feed this food court. So you go to wherever you want to get your food, then you just come out and they just share the tables. And here we are. Can you all see, do we need this? Yeah. Can you see this okay? I think we need to do the lights. Good. I just realized you're not seeing a lot, and I don't like the shadows.
Bottom button.
Is that better? Does that mean you hardly saw any of the first pictures? Well, anyway, too bad. So here we are at that food court. You get a basket. This is just a plastic basket with that beautiful dry, you know, the flat non-yeast bread. They slap it up on the clay ovens, you know, those... so interesting to watch. This is fattoush salad. You would get a big thing of just chunks of onions and mint leaves. So you sit there and you go, the dressing, you know, but then you just sort of watch the next table. That's how you learn. You just, okay, what are the locals doing? locals are picking up the onion and just, and then they take some mint and add to it and they just let it mix right in their mouth. I tried it once. And these are the napkins. They don't have napkins in a napkin holder. You get a box of, and they actually over there call it Kleenex. They don't call it tissues. Where's, Kleenex. So those are the napkins. And there you can see these are some of the teachers, my assistant principal and Miss Wendy and a few others. The food is unbelievable. This is called Shish Tawuk. Shish is chicken and a skewered chicken. Great spices. This is a falafel, which is chickpeas. They deep fry it. They put it in a pita bread and it's unbelievably good. They grill tomatoes, lots of parsley. I cannot for the life of me remember, this is a traditional Egyptian. Anybody familiar with Egypt? It's a simple word, but I can't think of it. It's kind of like we'd almost call it a macaroni hot dish, but it's still very, very different, and it is good. The food over there is good. The basic food, they call it, even though you're in Kuwait, it's Lebanese food. For some reason, Lebanon kind of has the star for it's our food, and every other country kind of adapts it a little bit, maybe other than Egypt. And at the end of most of the meals over there, you're served tea that is so incredibly sweet. Wow. It is super, super sweet, but fun, but fun. And then after we ate, we just kind of walked it's blocks and blocks and blocks. This is just a fabric shop, and just the colors just kind of blew me away. And cheap, 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 cheap. I'm gonna kind of keep moving. Anybody want to take a guess at what this little shop is? What are they selling?
Praying beads.
Pardon?
Praying beads.
You're right. Yep, those are prayer beads. In fact, up on my dish dash, I think I have a set of prayer beads hanging there for the men. They walk around even when they're dressed Western. Many of them dress just like this all the time, and their dish dashes sometimes. But they usually have their prayer beads hanging out, and they're just spinning them. It's just sort of like a habit, or sometimes they're just kind of counting them or whatever. But that's a shop that's just prayer beads. And you can see the clear plastic.
Yeah.
That's to keep the air conditioned air in. But over there, there is no concern. No concern. You're not going to like this. There's no concern for recycling, but there's no concern for conservation. It's such a rich country. Kuwait is about 7 times the size of Crow Wing County. So it's not large. And it has 10% of the world's oil. So they're very, very wealthy. They still are. And so they just, then lights are left on and air conditioners, it doesn't matter. Some of them even have their doors open. Question?
What did they do with the garbage?
Well, they do have garbage collection. It's a little iffy. And they have dumpsters. That's really good. Now, dumpster cats. I heard that phrase all the time. Oh, look at the dumpster cats. There's cat population has just exploded over there. Very few dogs, and they have dumpsters everywhere. I love the people, but Kuwait's dirty. The city's dirty, and there's garbage, and it's so hot that sometimes it's not pretty to smell either. Now, this is a first video clip, and I shot this because I didn't have my iPhone yet, but it's just a camera, and I hit video, and you're gonna hear, and you've heard about this, like I told you, the call to prayer. Now this guy doing the call to prayer is not real melodic.
Right.
You know, he's kind of flat.
You know, just preserve the low that call scene.
Anyway, while you heard that call to prayer, perhaps you heard a couple others. You know, like I said, there's hundreds, I'm sure there's over 1,000 mosques. And, you know, there's 5 prayer times a day, and they have a window of about 2 hours. In my head, I thought when I heard the call to prayer, everybody stopped. Mm-hmm. And they put their prayer rug down or they do their prayer. Kidding? They're shopping. They're eating. They ignore it. But the devout Muslims will find there. You know how when we go to airports now, sometimes you see the prayer rooms? They have those over there everywhere. They'll find a prayer room, and they have that 2-hour window where they know Allah's watching them, and so they'll eat, and finish, and okay, I have 15 minutes left, I'm gonna go in and do my prayers, which maybe takes 3 minutes. You know, they just go through them super fast. Some go to the mosque, but that's the people who have the time to do it. But anyway, those call to prayers are done 5 times a day, every mosque, and so the sound just echoes off other buildings, and there were some times where it almost would drive you crazy. And some of the callers of the prayers in the mosque were amazingly beautiful. I mean, they were like Josh Groban type guys. Beautiful voices. And then you had the guys kind of the screeching ones. This, I love this picture. This guy was so proud. He does nothing but sell dates. Many varieties of dates. And let me tell you, they were unbelievably good. And he would say, "You try date." I love the way they speak. You know, they really pare it down to small number of words. "You try date." So we did. And then, you know, you feel a little obligated and you wanted to buy them. And they're healthy, healthy, healthy. In fact, at the end of Ramadan, you've heard of Ramadan, at the end of Ramadan, when they break their fast in the evenings, they almost always, you know, Muhammad, the Prophet Muhammad, now if I was in Kuwait, I would have to say, peace be upon him, but he recommended that you break your fast with dates, and dates have been found to be very, very healthy, very, very nutritious. So anyway, a very proud man. Rugs. Unbelievable Persian rugs. Again, Kuwait produces very, very little. They are very wealthy, so things come into Kuwait. This is Hussein. He had two brothers, and I was introduced to these guys. A shacky, dumpy little place, but man, when you walk in, it's like ultra, ultra unbelievable. And their rugs are a few $100s up to multiple, multiple thousands of dollars. This little rug I have right here was given to me by a wonderful Kuwaiti man who just felt gracious. And a lot of them have so many rugs, they don't know what to do with them. I'm not even sure where that rug is from. But from Hussein, I bought two rugs. One rug, and they're both hanging in my home. One rug, if you bought it here in the U.S., would be about $1,200. I think I got it for about $400. Very reasonable. The other rug I have in my house, if you bought it here, like at, you know, the rug places in the Twin Cities, would be about $8,000 to $9,000. And I got it for about $1,500. So I thought I got two really good deals. Anyway, very neat guy. I think the next one just shows, yeah, just some of the varieties.
So where are they coming in from then?
Most of his are all Iranian. You can't say Persian. That's another no-no in Iraq. You do not call it the Persian Gulf. You must call it the Arabian Gulf. Because they don't recognize Persia because of their history with Iran and Iraq. So, and then at night, I was telling you about lights on all the time. So they have fake palm trees lit up at night in neon. I just couldn't believe it. Anybody want to take a guess at what that is?
Martini glass.
Those are water towers. Over in Kuwait, they call them the magic mushrooms. And at night, they're all lit up, and blue is the predominant color, but those are all water towers. Unbelievable. On the tops, they're painted white, obviously, to reflect the heat. I don't know why they don't have, you know, the sphere kind like we have. But just a unique picture. I just love that one.
Where does your water come from?
Good question. Good question. The water comes from the Arabian Gulf, not the Persian Gulf. The Arabian Gulf. They have two massive desalinization plants. So all of their water comes from the Arabian Gulf. They desalinate it. And their water's not too bad, although most of us always drank bottled water. And then, of course, they have that salt, and they do something with the salt. I can't recall. They don't salt their roads in the wintertime over there, but they have some purpose for the salt. We're still in orientation week. Now, school hasn't even started. I haven't even met my staff yet. They have not come in. Because we were administrators, we had to come in much earlier. So the three of us, they started calling us the Three Musketeers, because I got moved in, so I was in the same apartment complex. And this is in that Sultan Center, the grocery store that was right across the street from our apartment. And so, you know, sometimes we were so beat at the end of the day that we would just go over there, and they had this neat little kind of restaurant in the back. And so that was another way we became more familiar with the different foods that were available. And it was very good. And you can see we have our napkins. This is shot now. Wendy and I and Cleo, the three of us, we met a taxi driver, the expats, the Westerners it's amazing, when my teachers flew in, they wanted to get a taxi driver friend, because you depend on a taxi over there almost 100% to get around. There is some bus service, but it's a little iffy. And so I don't remember how we met Anwar. I think it was by chance in a parking lot. He might have just seen the three of us. You need a ride. And he's from Bangladesh, and he is now, he will be a lifelong friend of mine forever. The nicest man in the world. Muslim, from Bangladesh. His wife and his two kids are in Dhaka. I think it's Dhaka, isn't it? Bangladesh, yeah. And as so many thousands of other expats, the low-paid workers from Bangladesh, from India, from Egypt, and some of the other Middle Eastern countries, they come here to Kuwait because they can earn more money in Kuwait, even though they have to pay rent, than they would back in their home country. And then they send it back to their families. But I tell you, this man, Anwar, is just a fantastic, wonderful man. And he just, something clicked between the three of us and Anwar. And he loved being our guide and teaching us things about Kuwait and how to get around. And I'm a driver. I have to drive. I love cars. And I said, Anwar, after a year or so, I want to get my car. Okay, Mr. Jeffrey, I teach you. So we'd be going to different places, and he'd say, Mr. Jeffrey, what's that street called? He's like, oh, come on, Anwar, I don't know. No, you need to learn. You need to learn. And he would do that to me all the time, and thank God he did, because when I got my car, I knew how to get around. But anyway, he took us down to the south part. We're only about 5 miles from Saudi Arabia here, and this was our first time seeing camels. And these aren't camels like in a zoo. These are camels out in nothingness, out in the sand. That's their home. We're leaning against this massive pipe. This is a water pipe that took that desalinated water into that area, I think I told you at the beginning, called Wafra, where they grow the cucumbers and the onions. And I'll show you pictures of that later. I shot, there's Anwar with Wendy and Cleo, and that is barbed wire, not because it's a St. Cloud reformatory there, or prison. It's Saudi Arabia right there. And they are into their fences and their barbed wire and their guards and their guns. Not Kuwait, but Saudi, and at the North Iraq. That afternoon then, after seeing the camels, Anwar took us up and he says, I take you to Grand Mosque. You need to see Grand Mosque. And again, if you ever go to any of those Middle Eastern countries and you go to the main cities, A, you need to see the souks, the old markets, and B, you must go and see their grand mosques. Again, like I told you, Kuwait has over 1,000 mosques, one grand mosque. Amman, hundreds of mosques, one grand mosque. Istanbul, well, they've got the Blue Mosque, but anyway, unbelievable, the artwork, unbelievable. This is called a Diwaniya. There were some ladies that came in early this morning. I said, I wish we had a Diwaniya set up. The Diwaniya are these little cushions. You go to any Kuwait home, their living room are cushions, even though they're modern, you know, and they have their flat screen, you know, high-def TVs. They still have their Diwaniya, they have their tea, they have their shisha. I don't know if you've ever heard of shisha, their hookahs. Shisha are everywhere. When you're done with dinner, they'll roll. There are guys who would say, the busboy, he's a shisha guy. And he'll give you your charcoal, and he'll say, what flavor you want, you know, apple, plum, grape, and he'll put the tobacco on, and you sit there and smoke your shisha right there in the restaurant. And again, I'm not into smoke, but that's their way of life. So this is the Diwaniya outside the mosque, because there are so many people going through, you had to wait your turn to take your tour. This is a shot inside. This is just one little corner. I believe the Grand Mosque in Kuwait holds 7,000. And of course, there's no pews, you know, there's no chairs. The mosque is like this. And this really doesn't show it, but there's little demarcations. There's little painted, or on the carpet, little designs, so that each man knows where to kneel and do his prayers. Women are not allowed. Now, they're allowed here because it's not prayer time. But the women are up. There's like a balcony area in all the grand mosques where the ladies, they're always split. The women never pray with the men. But it was beautiful, and I had heard about this. The Muslim religion does not depict any images. And I kind of got that. They didn't want, they felt that, you remember the France thing, the comic thing, remember that a couple of years ago? All those French artists were shot because they did this comic book of Muhammad and all that kind of thing. Anyway, inside a mosque, it's all geometric designs. Unbelievable, intricate geometric designs. And that's a result of math. You know, the cradle of math is the Arabian world. And so geometry is just super, super important. I think I have another close-up. Yeah. This isn't the main dome. This is a little alcove off to the side. Now, Tracy, can you know how you take your fingers and spread out and that'll enlarge it? That's fine. Let it kind of refocus. Well, anyway, it's all tiled. It's all tiled. So if you take it back, Tracy, this, you know, this is maybe 30 feet across here. I mean, it's unbelievable. Now, like I said, that's just one little alcove. And the Grand Mosque in Kuwait is nothing compared to, probably the one I was most impressed with was the Grand Mosque in Beirut, Lebanon. That one was just beyond belief. Now I finally got to meet go to the school and start meeting people. The lady on the left here is the superintendent that I interviewed with in Boston. Remember I said this little kindly lady was sitting there and I visited with her. That is the superintendent of the largest international school in Kuwait, American Creativity Academy, where I was, and her name is Gertrude Gomez. And I was like, what? She's a Cuban-American? Her parents came over, is it the Mariel boat? Mariel, right? Her parents came on that, somewhere in the Florida area, that's where she grew up. She traveled to the Middle East as a teacher, met and married a Kuwaiti man, kept her name, and that's the one I interviewed with, a very, very nice lady. She was there for many years. I believe this year was her first year. She did not come back to the school, but anyway, it was just great. Now, this is just before the teachers arrived. Now, I kind of took you through the orientation of the city and all that, and now this is my school, the physical school. The hallways, their cubbies for their books, and very, very much like an American school, three stories. The first level was all kindergarten kids, 500 kindergarten kids. And this is one of the hallways of mine, and I was responsible for the boys, grades 1 through 5. There were about 550 boys. Loud, you cannot imagine the hallways there. Those of us who like kind of the quiet hallways and that, forget it. I gave up on that. It took me a few months. But loud, like you wouldn't believe, physical, push, shove, trip, hit. And you know where they get that from? Driving, when you see their parents with their horns. They'll cut you off. They'll bump right into you. Unbelievable. It's some of that old, you know, just out in the desert, and they're trying to merge some of that behavior into the new world, and there's a conflict. They're kind beyond belief. Their hearts are the biggest, warmest, but they're very pushy, very loud, and the boys mirrored the parents, especially on the highways. This is the mosque on the school campus. My school, even though we had the boys' campus and the girls' campus were split about 3 miles apart. And think of it as a Catholic school here in the United States. My boys, you had to be grade 3 to go to mosque. So if you're in grade 3, you would have your math classes. And my school was founded on Minnesota curriculum, believe it or not. Unbelievable. Standards and benchmarks, just like we have here. But instead of, you know, boys would go to mass every day, they go to mosque every day. Instead of having Latin class every day, they have Arabic class every day because they need Arabic class because they want to be like us almost to a fault. And instead of having catechism, they have Islam class. So very similar to a Catholic school. And this, believe it or not, is where most of the fights would start. In mosque. Two things. Anybody getting my clue? What created the conflicts of my boys? And then they'd come out on the playground after praying. I'm being honest with you. I mean, it's just like kids going to church or Sunday school fighting, and same thing. Which I thought they'd all be just these little, you know, little Muslim saint little kids. Anybody know the conflict in the mosque? Pardon?
Somebody was kneeling in their spot.
Yeah.
Nope.
No.
There is no spot. I mean, they would go to that spot. No.
Wanting to be first?
No. One more. Did I hear somebody say, not politics, Sunni Shia? You've all heard of that? Even third grade boys in a mosque. Because the Sunni
pray like this.
If you've ever seen,
I could have a Shia, I don't know. One was like this, and one was like this.
You're not praying. Unbelievable. The playground supervision staff would have to deal with it, and then guess who dealt with it in the afternoon?
Mr. Jeffrey.
Call up. Sometimes I have to get parents in. And of course, who are they learning from? And this is in Kuwait, where things are pretty calm. So no wonder this Sunni Shia thing is happening all throughout the Middle East. Kuwait is about 70% Sunni and 30% Shia. It all stems back to, I think it was the 1400s, this descendant of the Prophet Muhammad was killed, and there was a faction who were happy about it, a faction not, and that's what has developed into the Sunni Shia thing. But even on our campus with grade 3 boys. This is the mission statement and core beliefs. I'm not going to read it, but just scan it. You can put that in Lincoln School. You can put that out at Baxter School. You can put that at Brainerd High School. Inspiring excellence, lifelong process, effective communication. And that's because it's all based on Minnesota stuff. So Wendy and I were very proud. And finally, the staff came. So I was there for about 10 days before this picture was taken. And you can see some of my Arabic and Islam teachers. Most of them were from Egypt. They're meeting, and I tried to create some mixer activities. This man right here, that's my counselor, Mr. Muath, who's from Syria. Again, Muath is a friend of mine. He will be for life. What a kind man. Before I got my car for that first year, sometimes he drove me around, and he's a very devout Muslim, and I'm a, you know, I have a very strong faith and background. And so I'd ask him questions, and he'd ask me questions about Christianity. And man, it was almost scary how similar we are, you know. And then along comes Jesus, and they believe in Jesus. I was very surprised. You do? Yes, but he's a high prophet. He's not the Son of God. Anyway, so my staffer, it was so fun to meet them that first day. It was so fun to meet them. And about 4 days later, here we are, the first assembly. I call them gatherings. Sharon, remember our gatherings we had at Lincoln School? I actually sang, remember our Lincoln song? I actually sang it to them, and the boys loved it. But anyway, some of my staff are out here around, but this is about 500 and some boys, all dressed with their white shirts and black pants. And I kind of told them a little bit about who I was, and what a wonderful year, and how excited I was to be there, and great kids.
Now, were they English-speaking, or did you...
They were very English-speaking. They even got jokes. I mean, they even know some of those little subtle, you know, little things we do, the shortened versions of words. I can't think of one right now. When they would play on the playground, that would all be in Arabic. But when they were in class, everything, all the instruction is in English, everything. This is a grade 4 class. Oh man, I see these boys. You know, I was there 4 years. I got to know them very well. This little guy right here in the white, unbelievable kid. Smart beyond belief. We have no special ed there. So kids had to be at a certain level of academics. We did have some kids who over here would have been special needs. And some parents, I didn't even know this until we would have some meetings, were on medication for being hyperactive, beyond belief. They do bake sales to raise funds. They have a class called Life Skills, which teaches them to be caring. One of the tenets of the Muslim religion, like any Christianity too, is to care for those who are less fortunate than you. So they would have bake sales to raise funds, and then they would decide where they were going to send their funds. And I remember the biggest one, we raised a lot of money, and it went to Syria. They called it the blanket fund because of the Syria, when the whole thing was just starting with Syria and that whole refugees coming down into Jordan. So we sent, I don't know how many blankets, unbelievable, hundreds and hundreds of blankets. This is an interesting story. This is little Omar. This was a grade 3 or 4 student. That's his birthday cake. You have no idea their birthday cakes, how elaborate. You can see how it's been cut out here. There's the layers of it. Beyond words. And it would disrupt, you know, again, they're wealthy. They have their nannies. They have their maids. They have their drivers. So I'm in my office and I get a call. Mr. Jeffrey, would you come down to my room? I was teaching math and these guys come in with this freaking big cake. And I'm thinking, well, I didn't say deal with it, but it's like, oh, come on, it can't be. And I'd walk down there, it's like, oh, half the classroom is a boat. And all the students, like, this is Omar's birthday, so his parents, if there's 25 in the class, she buys 24 birthday gifts for all the other students in the class, and they were pretty elaborate gifts. But these cakes were just unbelievable. Now, this is Miss Christine. She was from just outside of Hollywood, California. She was a great teacher. At the end of the day, she said, Mr. Jeffrey, I had a birthday bash in my room today, and look what all the boys got for gifts. A police academy type thing. Could you imagine that happening over here? It felt like unbelievable. We had a character counts. I brought that from Lincoln School in Harrison to about every 6 weeks. We highlighted responsibility, perseverance, trustworthiness. And the boys really got into that. They really like to work towards goals, and they like certificates. That's why I've got some plaques over there that parents made for me. They're really into a lot of showy things, very showy things. But anyway, we would put them up on the wall, but this is little Dari, and he got one, and his parents come in. They absolutely love that. He was a great kid. This is another student of mine. This is Muhammad Al-Thaib. I remember his last name. And he loved his little painting here that he made of a bird. But every year I would have a principal of the day, a little drawing thing, they had to earn it. And he got drawn as the principal for a day. And he followed me around almost nonstop for the entire day. I had a couple meetings where obviously he couldn't be there, but great kid. And his dad was the head of their police academy, right on the golf, right on the beach, and he invited his class and the principal, that was good, to come over for a day. A huge Olympic pool, soccer fields, a private fishing pier. All the boys got to fish. There were servants out there baiting their hooks. You know, I think of us taking the bus and walking a trail to the Arboretum or something. But man, oh man, it was unbelievable. This is an Arabic award. I can't remember this little guy's name, but you can see this is all in Arabic. The Arabic Islam. The word American Creativity Academy, my school, the creativity I thought was going to be like art and music and theater and blah, blah, blah. The creativity had to do with the creative blend or marriage of Islamic faith and Western education. We didn't even have music. There was no music class. The founding fathers of the school was 15 years old. The founding fathers, I think, just felt that music is just too much, that Western influence. No, we'll have art. Art's art because geometric. They like the artwork, but no music. And if there was any theater, it was done through the Arabic Islam department. This is graduation of grade 5. Oh man, that's Khalid bin. It's not Khalid. My first few weeks it was like, hello Khalid. No, Mr. Jeffrey, Khalid. They have those cool sounds, and I want to be accurate and. And now it's just natural for me to say Khalid. But that's Khalid bin Essa, a very troubled boy for his first couple of years, and my counselors worked with him and his parents, and we got him through it, and he turned things around, and I'm very, very proud of him. I'm headed back there this spring. I'm gonna go back to Kuwait after being gone for 2 years. So Khalid would be in probably 8th grade, so I'm looking forward to seeing him and all the other kids again. This is quite a story. This parent was hot and cold, kindest, nicest man sometimes, but if he got the slightest feeling that his boy, who was quite overweight, was being teased, wow, he was on you like just, you know, and I kind of understood it, but I said, you know, this is the world. This is the way the world is. We'll work through it. We'll work through it. And we did. But he kept me on my toes, needless to say. But he was the man who ran the department at Kuwait University for flight controllers, air controllers. So he invited me out there to see the facility, which was fascinating. And I was thinking about taking some of my staff out there, but it never worked. But a great guy and his son. Speaking of overweight, Kuwait has the highest percentage of diabetes in the Middle East now. Like I said, they want to be like Americans to a fault. And so everything is over there, every fast food. And the Kuwaitis love going to all the fast food places 24 hours a day. They even have Hardee's hamburgers there, which just, that's Hardee's hamburgers, are you kidding? Food is big, and this is about halfway through my first year. I had kind of a New Year's banquet buffet, and I had this restaurant come and do this. I didn't think it was going to be this elaborate, but this is the norm. This is Miss Rehab. She's an Iranian, wonderful lady. Her husband's a heart surgeon. They fly to, in fact, she called me earlier this summer. They were in the Twin Cities. Teacher from Texas. Anyway, I wanted you to see this first platter. That is lamb, including the lamb's head. So if you go to the next one, there'll be a close-up of that. And I grew up on lamb. I love lamb. Oh, the lamb was so, so good, but it's a little odd to see the teeth right there. This is National Day. They love their celebrations. They're way into celebratory stuff, you know, those festivals. And so National Day, so this is the Kuwait flag, which you guys can't see, but here it is right here. So a couple of my teachers said, yeah, let's have a couple grade levels, do black, green, blah, blah. And then we did the shape of the flag, and it turned out just great. And, that doesn't show up very well, but that's the start of we had our assembly, and, oh, they're all dressed in their Kuwait colors. 2011 was the 50-25 celebration, 50-25. 50 years of independence from England. In 1961, they became independent from England. So there's a lot of British stuff there. 20 years of independence after the invasion of Saddam, and 5 years of the Emir. So the 50-25 celebration was a big, big deal. And they ended it with, they have it in the Guinness World Book. Remember the Kuwait Towers, that sphere thing? They had fireworks up it, down it, around it. It was the largest, they said, certain kind of fireworks in the world ever. This is International Week. That was National Day. This is International Week, where every one of my classes, there was 5 classrooms of each grade level, and so we had 25 classrooms, and each classroom adopts a country. I'm just wondering, how are we doing with that? Each classroom adopts a country. This was India, 2 of the teachers. I'm going to start flying because I've only got 10 minutes left. You know what country these boys did? This is a grade 3 classroom, Egypt, China. I mean, they're so into, you got to remember now, they have money. So those boys, all the parents went out and bought all those things. We said, no, you're only supposed to spend $10 or whatever. What a joke. Spain, look at these guys. Aren't they just great looking boys? Spain. So it's some more Spanish, Matadors, yes. And that's the teaching assistant. What a wonderful gal. She's from Lebanon. I can't remember her name right now. Oh, great personality. France, the Berets, India. USA.
Oh,
here's our USA guys. Look at those guys.
Yeah. That's great.
Oh man, they are just great. And now the next one is our next little video clip. And listen very carefully.
Thank you.
sports day, and of course soccer's, that's it. Football, that's it. They just, soccer's the only thing they want to play over there. We had Arabian dress day. That's my dish Dasha. That's one of my teaching assistants. Beautiful. You know, sometimes we think of the ladies just black. Just black. Not in Kuwait. They still are covered with their full of eyes and all that, but let me tell you, expensive fabric and all that sort of thing. That's the one I have hanging there. And then I also bought a, well, you don't buy, you have them made. They make them there for you. But they're super comfortable, super comfortable. And that's myself with Miss Gertrude again. And that's my winter dish, Dasha. These are some of the boys dressed up for Arabic day. Now, this is Mr. Anwar. What a wonderful man. He was the head of the Islam department, and he died after 1 year. And he was loved by every boy and every staff member. Kindest. You can just see his face. He was just like he looks. And that was the boy who was, they decided to make him be the prayer leader for our Hajj ceremony. If you've never heard of Hajj, Hajj is the depiction of people who take the pilgrimage to Mecca. And they go around that big square cube called the Kaaba. And they circle it, and hundreds of thousands of people, and they had that horrible stampede, or all those people were killed this year. It was terrible. Anyway, a great little kid. And these are the boys. There's the Kaaba. They're getting it all set up. You don't say Kaaba, it's Kaaba. Yeah, that second little sound. I'm trying. And that's Ms. Rehab's son. One boy is chosen out of the let's see, grade three did it, to be shaved. There's some symbolic, and I can't recall what the symbolism of the head shaving. A couple of the boys dressed up for the Hajj ceremony, and these were just wonderful parents. This is another gal who came to Kuwait years ago. She's American. She married this Kuwaiti man and has a family over there. This was another boy from another Hajj ceremony who was chosen to be the prayer leader, which is quite an honor. It's a huge honor. This was probably our most troubled student. I think his name was Abdullah. You can either say Muhammad or Abdullah, and you're probably 75% correct. And this was one of my, this was a great gal from Texas. She was a counselor. But he was a boy who was neglected. Mom didn't come home at night. A lot of what we dealt with at Lincoln School, just left. He'd come in dirty clothes, shoes missing, you know, shoes on the wrong foot. It was terrible. School was the best place for him.
So and what's here, the story on that one, Pee-wee? Where the heck was she?
Well, she was...
Were we prostituting?
I don't think she was doing that. Well, I don't know. I got her in only a couple of times, and it was pretty heated, and it was all done in Arabic, so... But she was a neglectful mom, and I finally slammed my... I remember once I slammed my hand down, and I said, you need to take care of your son, or we're going to... And then, you have to be careful what you say, because you don't want to say something you can't follow through with. But she was threatened with having her son taken away. I don't know how it finally ended up. If you play this, this will show the boys going around here. What you're hearing are some of those boys who are reciting verses from the Quran. Parents on the outside, TV, food, television is here covering it. It's a big, big, you gotta remember, this is the biggest international school in Kuwait. And then there are servants who are serving people tea and dates while they're sitting there. And this playground here that we're on is, again, covered. Everything's got those kind of sweeping fabric covers because of the sun. You can see how beyond that, that's hot. It's, you know, only about 105 or 10 inside here. Once in a great while, there's huge, huge rainstorms. I mean, just deluge, just boom, 2 or 3 inches. They don't have it set up to handle it, you know, with a sewer system, and so it floods. And so here you can see one shot that was taken. This is the girls' campus. This isn't mine, but somebody was in an apartment complex across the street, and I just some of these cars are actually starting to float down the street. Now, this next one is a video clip that, before you play it, this shows you, these are some of the things that I can't imagine this happening in the United States. The boys are floating down the gutter, and the parent is videotaping, and look how close the cars are. And you can hear the father laugh. When I first saw that, I was like, yeah, kind of like Jan, like, car, be kidding. But that's kind of that, I don't want to say that mentality, but just that attitude they have of being so adventuresome, they kind of forget about safety. And maybe that's because we're just so hung up on OSHA.
So.
Oh my God. If anybody here is an OSHA person, you'd have a heyday over there. Oh, unbelievable. They do this desert camp. They call it desert camp. They just have these huge areas out in the middle of nowhere where they put up, you can see that big kind of bouncy slide in the background. And my school just, we rented this camp and made the fire. We had four-wheelers and camel rides. That's, his name is Hamlet. He was the art teacher. Great guy. Oh, here's a little clip if you just run this, Tracy. These are some Egyptian men from my school. This is before everybody arrived. This is some of the kids playing. Once in a while there is a tree, but then those were planted because this is kind of a camp area, they call it. You see this man, he's swinging his prayer beads? But this is kind of that tempo, that beat that you hear when you're all done. I like it.
Yeah.
I like it a lot. So let's just, this is kind of a long one, so let's just pause it for the next. Yeah. I know some of you have to go, so if you need to get up and go, can I just continue?
Yeah.
Okay. This was my my last year I was there. This is Miss Kim. She's from Labrador. Isn't Labrador a province in Canada?
Yeah,
she's from Labrador. And a great, great gal, and she wanted to ride a camel. So here she was on a camel that night with a full moon. It was just a beautiful night to be out there. Now, this is a trip we took to Falaka Island. I think I told you earlier, Kuwait has 9 islands. All of them are uninhabited except for Falaka. Falaka has a little community on it that used to house about 5,000 people. When Saddam came from Iraq and invaded Kuwait, Falaka Island was his main place where all of his men went to, and then kind of came across the water into Kuwait. And so you'll see that in just a minute. But this is just one of the marinas in Kuwait. And you can see big boats, expensive boats. And I'm wearing proudly my Twins t-shirt. Now we're on Falaka, and this is one of the first buildings I saw. You know, I'm thinking in my mind, I'm thinking about this beautiful, kind of like, you know, Madden's, Cragen's, Grandview type thing. And that's what it was. Bombed out. This is a bank on Falaka Island that was one of the main targets of the army there. And on Falaka, there's a lot of old tanks, you know, that were bombed out probably by the Allied forces, and they're just kind of left there to, they don't rot, I mean, they're so dry, they just kind of stayed there, but it was kind of fun to climb around. And that one gal, I'm sure it had enjoyed having her picture taken. There are a couple things out on the island that they maintain. This is a nice little resort area, and there's a pool inside there. Very small, but still tastefully done. If you saw the posters that CLC had around, and in the, I don't know, the paper, but that's one of the photos I took. This was a camel herdsman, and these are the Amir's camels. His camel range, or whatever you want to call it, farm, is on Falaka Island. Beautiful, beautiful camels. In Kuwait, they have an emir, not a premier or president. They call it an emir. And it's not, he's not elected. It's the Al-Sabah family. It's in a generation to generation. But they do, Kuwait was the first Arabic country to go modern enough to have, it's called a constitutional emirate. They elect a parliament, people can vote, but the emir is the emir. Kind of like the Queen of England, that sort of thing. But here you can see the camels. Miss Kim drank warm camel milk. I couldn't do it. I just couldn't do it.
And on Falica, they unearthed, this is from Alexander the Great. This is a couple thousand years old, and ruins that they're slowly excavating there. And then on the way back, somebody shot a picture of us. This is this little guy here. This is Abdullah. I got to know Abdullah probably almost better than any student. He's the son of the superintendent's secretary, who I got to know very well. And Abdullah's older brother is Omar, and he's the one who's graduating this coming spring, and I'm going back for Omar's graduation. I promised him I would come back. And I thought 2 years was enough time to be gone for a while, and yet everybody will remember me, and I'll remember them. So I'm really looking forward to seeing Abdullah and Omar again. Christmas, this was so odd. There's one Catholic church in Kuwait. It's in an area they call the compound. There aren't Lutheran churches and, you know, that kind of thing. There's one Catholic church and there's one Protestant, I'll say, church there. And so I tried going to the Protestant church a couple of times there. And each time I went, it was a Filipino service. So it was none of it was in English. But I did have a few friends. Once in a while, we'd get together and just, you know, kind of share our faith and have kind of a Bible study kind of thing. But the Christians were allowed to have a very nice Christmas celebration in the compound. They had a big fire, big logs going at night, you know, it cooled down to 90 degrees, so a nice warm fire feels good. And so they had these huge Christmas trees. And this is a little clip that'll just show you. They put the lights in the palm trees here, and this is right in the middle of the city. It was kind of funny because we did a couple Christmas carols, and then when we stopped, you could hear the call to prayer in the background. Just that contrast was fascinating. And there are hundreds of people there. You can see the fire. Very Christmassy, but obviously not Minnesota. This is Kuwait, again, has that money, so they do things up really, really big. And nobody wants to go to Kuwait. They all want to go to Abu Dhabi, Oman, Dubai. So they had a world-class sand sculpting contest. And in this area, they just put all these colored lights. It's just almost over the top, but still beautiful. That's a sand sculpture. And I mean, that's probably 30 feet up to the top. This isn't small, this is almost full size.
Wow.
And the detail,
oh my God.
Just unbelievable. Unbelievable. And of course, at nighttime was the time to go. That was the time to go. Now, I was there for one of the darkest, worst sandstorms ever. I had heard of sandstorms. And in my mind, you know, I'm thinking, wind, and just the sand, just, you know. Not anything like that. It was Miss Cleo's 50th birthday, and so we took her down the south end of the city. It's called Fahil, and there's some beautiful restaurants. We took her to this restaurant. We're looking at these beautiful fountains, and there's people milling around, and there were about eight of us, and we were just about ready to go into the restaurant to eat, and we started seeing people turn around, you know, pointing. Of course, you turn around and point, and there was this just, like, wall up in the sky, and everybody's just standing there, not a sound, just watching it, and it was like that, but this isn't the one that I saw. It was much darker. And it looked like it wasn't moving, but it was moving, but very, very slow. And about 10 minutes later, it was like right here. And about 2 minutes later, it's just almost like smoke that just drifts down. And let's see, I have a video clip that I would like to show you. We won't run it very long. Hopefully I can find it. Oh, shoot. One second. No, it's gone. Oh well. Anyway, it's let's get back to the pictures here. Well, maybe I shouldn't have done that, huh? Strangest thing. What I'm getting at, it was sunny, bright, and for the next 8 hours, it was as dark as midnight. Just unbelievable. And then when it leaves, everything has like a 16th, 1/8 of an inch of dust over it. Just like talcum powder. Not gritty, it's just fine, fine, fine. Strange, strange thing.
So you have to stay indoors?
You pretty much have to, yeah.
What are you doing out like you were? Where do you go now?
Well, we all went into the restaurant, good question, but they had to shut down because they couldn't have their exhaust fans on. It would just grind their equipment. And people would take their napkins, which is really...
Kleenex.
And you put it under your bridge, so you have a napkin hanging over your face.
That's, you saw the people doing it? So you did. I turned 60, and so, oh man, totally over the top. These are the waiters and waitresses. And this is, again, the party we had, and there's my bald guy, Mr. Moa, who is just, I respect that man immensely, immensely. Now that's Anwar, that's my taxi driver again. I just wanted you to see a close up. Just a super nice guy. This is a guy I met, Abu. He creates these little ships. These are called dhows, and one of his ships is right over there on the wall there. I'm sure we can take a look at it. But these were the original Kuwaiti fishing vessels. And before oil, Kuwait was known for pearl diving. The pearls from Kuwait were like the most prized pearls from that part of the world. And then oil came, and Japanese with their culture of pearls, and so the pearl diving industry kind of went into the background. But what a nice man Abu is.
What would be the cost of one of those ships?
That ship over there, well, probably if you bought that in Kuwait, you could get that for maybe $35. Very reasonable. Here, if you bought it at a place, it'd be probably $135. This again is Miss Kim. This is Mr. Krister. He's also from Canada. He was the assistant superintendent. He was the principal of the school before I came over there. But this is out at one of their malls, and they got, I don't know if any of you know, Tim Hortons in Canada is like McDonald's here.
And they opened up the, whoop. Okay, I probably just went dead.
Yeah, your battery just died.
Okay. They opened up, they opened up the first Tim Hortons in the Middle East was in Kuwait. Kuwait was like the testing ground for McDonald's. There are thousands of Starbucks in Kuwait, and now there are hundreds and hundreds of Caribou coffees in Kuwait. So it's very, very Western, very Western. Is this gonna work with me just talking loud? I'll see how long I can last. This is a Kuwaiti now. Very nice gentleman. He was the father of some of our students, and he was very gracious. Said, "Mr. Jeffrey, you bring Miss Kim, you bring Miss Wendy, you come have lunch in my diwaniya." And so this is his diwaniya. His is raised up a little different, but still very, very nice. And his diwaniya is at the base of a new bank that was being built. Next picture. Thanks, Tracy. Huge, massive bank right next to his diwaniya. And this is what I was saying about the old with the new, just side by side. You go to Dubai, I mean, everything. I would never go back to Dubai. Dubai is very artificial. I just didn't care for it. But everything is like gleaming steel, glass. That's all it is. At least, to me, Kuwait has some character to it. I love to cook, and so one of my two of the teachers, and she's from the girls' campus. We took a Arabic cooking class, chicken makbous, which was very, very good. So that's something we did. I wanted to pick up on the culture a little bit. They love their rice and saffron. Delicious. Now this is a clip. The school had this group. It was called the Climate Committee, and it was a chance for you to learn more about the culture and just the local city. And so we went to this one area with this beautiful building. And now look at all the geometric patterning, and the everything's geometric. This is a government building. This isn't a religious building. Inlaid tile.
the title come from?
Good question.
Okay.
I'm not sure. I'm just not sure. And there are many buildings like that. Camels are big there. They have camel races. They have a camel racetrack. I was very turned off by it, but I wanted to experience it. I like this, the color, and that's one of our teacher's little boys. But when I saw the race, it was like, the racetrack, I believe, is a 3-mile racetrack. And when the camels went by us, they're frothy. I thought, huh? But again, that's a cultural, that's what they have done for hundreds of years. Here's a clip, and you'll see, they used to have little boys, that was outlawed, and now they have little mechanical guys up on the top. But all they do is whip them. And if you look at the mouths, I think you might see some of that froth. I just did not find that attractive. Anyway, so camel races, had to try that. And yes, they do eat camel, but I never was able to try it. I never was in any place where they were doing, I would have tried camel. This is another Kuwaiti parent. I joined the bike club. I'm a big bicycler, and I loved a mountain bike and road bike. And they had a desert bike club. It was called the DBCK, Desert Bike Club of Kuwait. And actually, before I left, I got online and they had a website, and I thought, thank goodness. And so on the weekends, we would go biking. Now over there, the weekends are Friday, Saturday. Sunday is the first day of the work week. What does that do to your DNA? Oh, man. I was still saying no when we were having meetings the week before. I say, well, on Monday, let's make sure. And somebody said, Mr. Jeffrey, you mean Sunday? It's like, oh, yeah, that's right. Sunday's the first day of the week. Now, in Saudi Arabia and some of the other countries, the weekends are Thursday and Friday. Kuwait was smart. When that whole oil thing happened in 1938, they found the oil in Kuwait. It didn't take very long for them to realize, with Thursday, Friday as a weekend, we're losing on the world stock market, so to speak. We're losing business. So they shifted their weekend one day. So they only lost Saturday. So anyway, but this Kuwaiti gentleman, very, very kind. So we're on our bike ride, and every weekend, one guy would be the leader, and they knew about, they got permission from this gentleman, yes, you can come to my farm. And so this is his farm, and this is his field. His farm, they call them farms, but we would call them gardens. Beautiful, expansive gardens. Little clip here. This is his backyard of his farm. Just unbelievable. And then we sometimes, when it would get really, really warm, we'd have to do our rides in the city because we couldn't get out to the desert.
So Kuwait has all this oil. Does each Kuwaiti or each Kuwaiti family, like Alaska, get amount of money each year? Is that how it works?
It doesn't work that way in Kuwait, but what works is when you get married, you get a massive sum of money from the Kuwaiti government to build your first house. In our dollars, I think it's like $300,000, something like that. So there are ways that the Kuwait government takes care of Kuwaitis, yes. And that's one reason why Kuwait has been so calm and basically peaceful. Yeah, they do take care of them. But they don't get, they help, and they also help with college, with the college education. I think that might be paid by the Kuwaiti government as well. So there are definitely perks that they get.
Come on, healthcare.
You gotta get married.
Healthcare. Well, healthcare over there is top notch. Most of the doctors, when they found out I was from Minnesota, they said, "You know Mayo? You know Rochester?" They knew that. But as you were talking more like insurance kind of healthcare. I don't know what they had. I think if you're Kuwaiti, you probably had no problem with any kind of healthcare. And their healthcare facilities were second to none.
Is the country basically all bilingual?
Yes.
Everybody speaks English?
Yes. Yes. Even the older folks. Yeah. Yeah. You know, America, we saved them. Of course, that was recent. That was 1990. But even before that, the British. It wasn't our influence. It was the Brits. Yeah. This is one of the mosques on the far edge of Kuwait City. And you can see this man, you know, if you have a lot of money, you can build a mosque and name it the Al Jeffrey Mosque, I can do. So he named this mosque for himself, and he designed it after the Taj Mahal. And you can walk in, here's some of the gals from our club. You know, the mosques are wide open, you can walk in. It's fascinating. It is fascinating. This is, good friend of mine from the bike club. Oh, I'm sorry, I can't remember his name all of a sudden. One of my closest friends from the club. I feel terrible about that. He's from Iran. And he went through some difficult times and finally was able to get away, and he moved to Kuwait, raised his family there. His wife's from the Philippines, loves to ride motorcycles. His dream is to come to the U.S. and East Coast to West Coast on a motorcycle. And I said, well, when you do, you got to come through Minnesota, don't you know? This now is quite a story. Kuwait is comprised of about 4 million people. 1.2 million are Kuwaiti citizens. The rest, the 2.8, are expats from America, from Canada, from Bangladesh, the higher paid, although I was paid less than I was paid here in the United States. But your housing's taken care of, so it's still a good deal. And the low-paid expats, the Anwar Bangladeshi taxi driver, the Indian guys who wear the little zip yellow smocks who sweep the streets in the morning, the Indians who clean the beaches. Oh, my. People go to the beaches there at like 9 o'clock at night and might start their grills at 11 and eat at midnight, and the kids are playing frisbee and stuff at 1, 2, and then they go home at 4, 5. Just the opposite because of the heat. Not during school, I'm talking like Ramadan and summers and all that. But anyway, the other group of people in Kuwait, so you've got the Kuwaitis, the expats, and then you've got about 150,000 what they call Bedouins. Not Bedouin. The Bedouin are what we would call nomadic, semi-nomadic. They travel around. But they have a nationality. They have a passport. The Bedouins in Kuwait don't have passports. They don't have any citizenship. There's a variety of reasons. If a Kuwaiti gal marries, or not marries, has a child with a Bedouin, that child's a Bedouin. No citizenship. No passport. No real identity. Kind of a weird thing. It's still one I can't completely grasp. Other reasons that people were Bedouins is, you know, Kuwait was the place to go to in the 50s and 60s and 70s. They were the most progressive Arabic country in that whole region. And so people from other countries wanted to go there, and a lot of them became like the police and the military. And the Kuwaitis, rather than hassle with like, well, you were Egyptian and you know, there might be problems. We're just going to make you just no citizenship and we'll figure it out. Well, they never figure it out. And they sort of became Bedouins. Weird. But anyway, long story short, we were on a bike ride out here in this camel farm area. One of my good friends, I noticed he was a little behind, and there were a couple kids running to him. And I thought, oh, well, you know, being a teacher, principal, I'm going to go meet some little kids. And they must live out here. Maybe their dads are camel herders or whatever. You never know what kind of story you're going to hear. So I start riding my bike back, and just about where that back wall is where my friend was. And I get there, and all of a sudden, two or three more kids come. And they were about 20 feet from us, and then they would, from behind, this is 100% true, they pulled out sticks, a metal rod, and they started coming to us, whacking us. Whacking our bike. I got hit on the arm. I mean, it was scary. I mean, yeah, these were like 8-9-year-old kids, but they had the whackers. We didn't have the whackers. We were getting whacked. And they're like not speaking English, and they're kind of raggedy. I mean, barefoot. I'm almost sure, and of course I didn't research and go back and talk to their parents. We biked the heck out of there and got back with our group. But I think these were probably kids, Badoon children, who just, that was their entertainment for the day or something. I don't know. But it was a very, very weird thing. Thank you. And this, that happened either before or after this little video I shot. You can see all those Badoons are just living in those little fabric, well, not so little, but those tents. Just amazing. Yes?
What do camels eat? What do the camels eat? I don't see anything that they can eat.
Your guess is as good as mine. They ate something. I mean, they had something there for them. Some kind of feed. I don't know.
My grandson, who was a Marine, was there.
Yes.
And I got from him, Grandma, what do camels eat? So I went on the internet and researched
this. Good.
And it said, they can find the thorniest whatever debris, and they've got these...
Kind of like goats.
Various stomachs that they go through, and how long they can go without water. But I laughed because that was his grandma.
I shot this because this is almost kind of a joke. Aromathia is kind of a small little suburb. Their post office, there really is no postal service in Kuwait. It was unbelievable. If anybody tried to send something to me, I said, you've got to send it to our school. There's really no postal service. So that's an old sign, and I just kind of got a kick out of it. Post office. Next one, Tracy. You can't really tell, but we're on the Corniche. Corniche, I don't know if you've ever heard that. Corniche is a term that you would hear in Abu Dhabi and Dubai. Anywhere where there's a waterfront, Beirut has a beautiful Corniche. It's their waterfront, their walkway, and all the development along the beach. And Kuwait does have about a 7-8 mile long Corniche. Very nice, and so some of the times we would ride the Corniche if it was too hot to go out onto the desert. But this is a restaurant, and it's log-sided. I just thought you'd get a kick out of it. And you can't really tell. They actually did a log-sided, sort of like North Woods. I just thought, oh, that's funny. There's a horse that didn't make it, and it's just out in the desert when we were bike riding, and I just shot a picture, and you can just see it sort of dries up and dehydrates. Now, this is that area I told you about, Wafra, where they brought that desalinated water in and they grow the cucumbers and onions.
Oh, yeah.
And the other thing they grow is potatoes as well. And I'm not quite sure what this crop is, but I wanted you to see how green it was in this little area in the south part of Kuwait. And this is the McDonald's potato field for French fries. They grew them right there. Big sign. I should have shot a picture of the sign. And I think, here's my bike club. And we're in Wafra now, just kind of talking and looking. I tell you, when you bike these areas, you really got
that?
You're getting to know how things work. You know, you're in a car on the highway, you would never see this, but we biked right into the fields. It was fascinating. This is some of the remnants. You know, Kuwait is, like I said, 7 times the size of Crow Wing County. So there are some areas out in the middle of nowhere, which pretty much Kuwait all is, but where they haven't like cleaned it up. They just left the remnants of the war. And so these are old bombed out buildings out in the middle of nowhere. This is quite a story. These boys are from my school. We were out biking up in this area called Mutla Ridge, where there were a lot of battles during the invasion. And we're biking along over these little hills, kind of little bumps, really. And all of a sudden, way off in the distance, one of the guys from the club says, Jeff, they're saying Mr. Jeffrey, huh? And then as we get closer, Mr. Jeffrey. And here come these guys, they're all my students. Their parents, they had a camp out there, a big, huge tent. And so they come over. This is Mr. Ty. Oh, great guy. He's from Lincoln, Nebraska. He is married to Leah Albrecht,
Anybody know Chuck and Debbie?
Yes.
Chuck and Debbie Albrecht. So those are his in-laws. Super good teacher. Wonderful guy. So they talked to us and they invited us into their Winia. I think I have the picture. Yes. So out in the middle of this desert, out in the middle of nowhere, they have, you know, their servants are kind of in the back with water, cooking, and we had tea, and just that was just something else. There were about 10 of us who sat in there, had tea and some little, you know, cookies, and just wonderful. That is a picture of the last report card that I signed my fourth year. I was the principal there for 4 years. They are way into grades. Oh my God, I had some parents say, basically what they were saying is, I will pay you if you give my son an A. Grades, again, they are very much into outward appearances and they want their child to be A, no matter what. And of course I held my ground and got sticky, but I think deep down inside they understood where I was coming from. But every quarter, we were on the quarter, so four times a year I would have to sign, and every student got their academic one, and then they're like their behavior grade, work ethic one. So I had to sign, and I didn't do Jeffrey, I did J. DeVaney. So 500 boys, so 1,000 each quarter. So each year, 4,000, I did 16,000 report cards. That was the 16th, thousand, whatever it is, the last one. I shot a picture of it. And they had a wonderful going away for me when I, you know, told them that, no, oh, Mr. Jeffrey, we know you come back. Everybody come back. Like boomerang. A couple of them, they'd always say that, they'd say, like boomerang. No. I tell you, I went over for two. I was so enthralled, and I had made such good friends and met such super cool people. And the traveling from Kuwait is, I haven't even got there yet. Beyond description. I thought, I'm not going back after 2 years. I'm going to stay for a third year. Well, that third year was like I was still doing the traveling and the people. I can hang in for one more year. But that last year, those frustrations, the driving, the noise, the people would come and cut in front of you in line because they were dressed in their dishdasha. You know, you kind of, go. That last year I said, no, I have been here standing, you're behind me. I mean, I had been there long enough, but I was done with that. 4 years was enough. But anyway, I got just a beautiful cake and had a great party. That's some of my staff, the wonderful kids, young kids, and they're into those plaque things big time. Miss Kim, I don't know, we didn't color coordinate. These are some of my teachers and teaching assistants. This is typical dress up dress for ladies in Kuwait. Elegant, I mean, I'd say elegant. They still have their hijab, they're covered, but boy, are they into makeup too. Big time makeup. This is Manal. This is the mother of those two boys. The oldest one is graduating this year. A wonderful, kind-hearted, fantastic lady. Manal Alotevi. She's Palestinian. She's from the Palestine area. There are many Palestinians in Kuwait. And I heard their perspective of the whole Palestine-Israel thing. But what a kind, kind lady, Manal. I love it. That was my car, a Mitsubishi Pajero. We don't have Pajeros here. I think they call them Outlanders, maybe. Good car. It hauled three mountain bikes we could put in the back, and it got me around for 3 years. And I actually drove it to Bahrain. A teacher of mine, a real adventuresome kid, we got travel visas. Temporary visa to drive across Saudi Arabia and go into Bahrain. Man, was that what an experience that was. And that's my speedometer, 50 degrees, that's about 126, which is what it was most days, is 120 to 130. This is my last picture I wanted to share with you. I'm a huge coffee drinker and I'm a caribou guy. Caribou's everywhere and everything is takeaway. They call it takeaway. Everything, you could get anything takeaway. And my teachers would call twice a day during the school day, and the caribou guy would come over with the scooter and the Americanos and the frappes and the this and that. And so Nancy and I go out to Caribou quite often, and the manager, Jeb, I showed him this picture. He's the caribou manager of Baxter. I said, Jeff, next year I'll be your driver. You get the scooter. He went down to the cities. You know, Caribou is a Minnesota-based company, and he went down to the mothership in the Twin Cities for a meeting last week. He showed them this picture that I emailed them. He said, we need to do that up in Baxter. I don't know if they're going to do it or not. But anyway, the rest of my pictures are, like I said, the traveling from Kuwait. The other thing that kept me going was the travel. Kuwait, if you look at a map, you go 360 around Kuwait. Well, to the north, you've got Iran and Iraq. You just don't travel in Iran and Iraq right now. You could, but no. Turkey, 2 hours. Beirut, Lebanon was the first trip I took. Beirut, Lebanon is beyond belief. They used to call it the Paris of the Mediterranean. And do you remember, those of you who are my age, remember the Danny Thomas show?
Yes.
Do you remember Uncle whatever?
Toulouse.
What was his name?
Toulouse.
Yeah, wasn't he from Lebanese?
I think so.
I thought he always talked about Lebanese. Remember, he had the big nose. Beirut, Lebanon, unbelievable. And that was our first trip we took in October. You know, there's for the Islamic holidays, we would close for 2 days or a week or whatever. Well, the Western staff, you get on the airplane in Kuwait, and an hour later, 2 hours later, you're in Amman, Jordan. Oh my God, Amman, Jordan, unbelievable. Dubai, Abu Dhabi, Qatar, Bahrain is 40 minutes away. It's like flying from here to Minneapolis almost, and you're in Bahrain. Although Bahrain is not anything special. But then you've got India, Sri Lanka we went to. All those places are 3 or 4 hours away. Unbelievable travel. So I have just highlights. Do you want to see, if you don't have to go, do you want me to keep going?
No.
Because it's past 1 o'clock. Pardon? Okay, I'm going to keep, if you have to go, go. So. Yeah, but I would like you to stop and look at things too on the way out. So maybe let's take a 5 minute break.
That's
if you want to look at things, and I'll show the recipe that I have.
Thank you.
Thank you. Glad you came.
Hi, Skip.
Where are we?